Cool. All right. Check. My name is Parker Hinton. I'm an undergraduate at the University of Colorado at Boulder. And I do my research at the Laboratory for Atmosphere and Space Physics. I'll be presenting to you today on the story of how I visualized the EO Plasma Torus. Exciting. Spoiler alert, this is the model of the EO Plasma Torus that I made. I did all my visualizations in the MATLAB environment, so I'd love to chat about that with people afterwards. So this tint screen here will be displaying our toolbox that I'll fill up with you guys as I go with tools that we use to build the 3D model. So we're going to start out. EO, what is EO? It's the innermost Galilean moon of Jupiter. It outgasses a ton a second of volcanic material, which through various transport mechanisms ends up co-rotating with Jupiter, trapped in the magnetic field. This is because these particles get ionized by the plasma torus, so they are trapped in the magnetic field. This is the most volcanically active body in our solar system, Io, the moon of Jupiter. And this process causes radio emission, which is the largest radio emission in our solar system, second only to the sun. Basically, alphane waves propagate along these magnetic field lines, which create potentials that excite electrons that ultimately excite gases in the ionosphere of Jupiter that emit this radiation. Also, we have a spacecraft flying around Jupiter right now who's flying through the EO Plasma Torus and whose signals are being affected by this torus. So what we have here is motivation added to the toolbox, and we'll go to the next slide. Okay, it looks like the toolbox isn't working, but pretend it says motivation here. So our story begins in September of 1977 with Voyager 1, which had on it a plasma instrument. This is the PLS instrument. I have the actual picture of it blown up here in the corner. And what I've done, I've mapped Voyager 1's trajectory through the Jovian system there for you. And you'll see it goes in and it goes out. It was a gravitational assist. The data that I use for my modeling is just the inbound pass as of yet, which is about 10 hours of data. So what Voyager did, this PLS instrument, it took density and temperature measurements as it flew in towards Jupiter. And this, basically, we got the radial profiles of these two quantities, and we're going to use that to model the plasma in the environment. Next slide, please. So what I've done here, the pink dots are locations in the magnetosphere where Voyager 1 took data. So we have density and temperature measurements at each of these pink dots. And I've traced along magnetic field lines to two locations on the magnetic field line. There's a white dot and a blue dot. I hope you can see the blue against the black, because that's the most important location. The blue dot is the centrifugal equator. This is, if you were to draw a line from the magnetic field down into the spin equator, this is going to be the point along the magnetic field line that's furthest away from Jupiter. This is where the centrifugal forces are strongest, and this tends to concentrate the ion populations at these locations. So you have the ion populations concentrated at the blue dots, essentially. And what this does is it creates a positive mass that then creates an ambipolar electric force that draws in the electrons and satisfies charge neutrality. So a few things to note here. This magnetic field is tilted from Jupiter's spin axis. It's tilted about 9.6 degrees. And when we get to the model eventually, that's going to result in a sort of wobbly motion that we see with all of our spacecraft and our ground-based observations. So to our toolbox, now we have the magnetic field model and an understanding of Jupiter's magnetic equators. Next slide, please. So how do I take that one line of data that Voyager got and turn that into a model of the entire system? The answer is my advisor's PhD thesis from back in the day, which is essentially using plasma physics. It's diffusive equilibrium is what we call the assumptions. So we take the four forces that act on a charged particle along a magnetic field line, and we balance them. Full disclosure, we ignore the force of gravity. It's about 10 to the 3 times weaker than other relevant forces in this region, such as the centrifugal force. So the ambipolar electric force, the pressure gradient force, and the centrifugal force, so we're in the frame of the particle, and we balance those forces, so we set them equal to an F net of zero, so where there won't be basically an acceleration. And ultimately, this yields an equation for us, where if we know the number density at one point along a magnetic field line, we're able to calculate, extrapolate the number density anywhere else along that same magnetic field line. So I did one example here. This is at M shell equals 6. That means we're about 6 Jupiter radii away. And I only show 3 species here because if I plotted all of them, you wouldn't be able to tell what's going on. But we plot 8 species. And I want to just point out some differences in their behavior. This blue line here is hydrogen. Hydrogen feels the ambipolar electric force from all this positive charge in the middle more than oxygen and sulfur, for example, because it's a lot lighter. So what this force causes hydrogen to distribute more evenly along a field line. So that's what this plot's showing here, is the distribution of each of these species along a magnetic field line. With the kind of center of the line here. So you can kind of imagine orienting that sideways. A few things to note, we see concentrations at the centrifugal equator as expected. And the other two species I've plotted here for you, oxygen singly ionized and doubly ionized sulfur, are the largest ion populations in the ion plasma torus. That's because the source is EO. Its volcanic activity is sulfur dioxide, which disassociates. Okay, so you can imagine plotting a bunch of these densities and their magnetic field lines next to each other and generating a contour plot for each species. That's what I've done here with doubly ionized sulfur. And already we're starting to see the structure of the torus. You see a cold inner torus and what we call a warm outer torus. They're different by both species composition and temperature, with temperatures in the cold inner torus about 1 to 10 EV, and in the outer torus in the order of a few hundred. And you can imagine taking every species and adding all those contour plots together to yield a total charge plot or an electron density plot because it's necessary to satisfy charge neutrality. So if we plot a bunch of contour plots in 3D space, you can kind of get an idea of what our model is going to look like. Let's just jump to that. So through the moons in there for context, Jupiter rotates in 10 hours, so this is obviously not up to real time, but the relevant orbits are all correct, approximately. So you see this wobbly motion that I talked about. This is because we have this tilted dipole magnetic field about 10 degrees from the spin equator. And it's kind of hard to see from this perspective because we're side on, but we have the cold inner torus inside of this warm outer donut. So we have a spacecraft orbiting Jupiter right now. Its signals are affected by this plasma torus. And there's a poster, not mine, but they use my model as an example to basically figure out what their actual signals would be. Next slide. So this is a pretty picture Juno took. I haven't mentioned Juno yet, but we're comparing our data basically with what that spacecraft is finding right now and using it to be part of the mission. So our takeaway here, guys, is that Voyager measured the EO plasma torus and we used it to create this visualization. Future work, we want to add time duration. We know there's day-night side differences. Volcanic activity on EO may cause differences, and there's longitudinal differences. So that's all very relevant in the field right now, and these are things we want to work on. I want to thank NASA, Juno, AGU for allowing me this opportunity. Last, my employer, and more directly, my advisor, Dr. Fran Vaginal. With that, we have 5 minutes for questions.